I'm Marcia Welsh, president of East Stroudsburg University, and I really thank you so much for joining us for the first event in the Distinguished Entrepreneur Speaker Series featuring ESU alumnus Dan Dizio. Today's event marks the beginning of an exciting program at ESU as entrepreneurs invite us into their world to hear their stories, sharing insights for pursuing our own passions. Throughout my academic career, it has always been my passion to seek out innovative opportunities that support student success. Since coming to ESU, I've been inspired by the entrepreneurial spirit that has been the heart of this university for over 120 years, and which guides our students on their journey to success. As the CEO and founder of the world's largest Philly-style pretzel bakery, Dan Dizio, a 1995 graduate of ESU, is a prime example of this success. He is here to tell us about his successes and failures that brought him to where he is today. After graduation, Dan briefly worked as a stockbroker before he and his college roommate, Len Lehman, agreed to take the plunge, starting a business together. Len graduated in 1994 and at that time was a psychiatric counselor. Dan presented a plan to Len to go into the pretzel business. It was something he knew a little bit about, given that at the age of 11, he would help a neighbor sell bags of fresh pretzels to drivers stopped at red lights in Northeast Philadelphia. It wasn't easy, but through hard work, perseverance, and a lot of knowledge picked up along the way, Philly Pretzel Factory has grown to more than 200 locations in 19 states. The company now boasts sales of more than $700 million and will sell more than 175 million pretzels this year. Philly Pretzel Factory is listed among the top franchises in Entrepreneur Magazine and Franchise Market Magazine, and their offerings have consistently won local Best Pretzel contests. As the company's CEO, Dan Dizio is a recipient of the Excellence in Franchising Award from Smart CEO Magazine, and he was a finalist for the Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year Award. ESU couldn't be prouder to have Dan and Len's story as a part of our legacy of accomplished alumni. And I have to say, Dan comes up for homecoming. Dan shows up when we ask him. He has been an absolutely incredible alum. I've asked him not to tell you everything about his history, because but he does. It's interesting to see how he and his classmates still stick it out. They come together. They do a lot of things together. They really were a force to be reckoned with. So, in addition to his insights, the insights that Dan will share with us tonight, I'd also like to highlight another opportunity for ESU entrepreneurs, and especially students who are looking for that first step toward making their own mark in the world. ESU's Business Accelerator has worked with hundreds of entrepreneurs for nearly two decades to provide support and resources for startups and established businesses alike in the profit and the not-for-profit world. In the audience tonight, we have two previous first place winners of the State System Student Business Plan Competition, Jonathan Weber, class of 2012, and Blaise Delfino, class of 2016. Both of these accomplished alumni have gone on to create companies and serve as mentors for future entrepreneurs. I highly encourage anyone who is inspired by Dan's words tonight, which I trust will be all of you, to seek out the ESU Business Accelerator as Jonathan and Blaise have done, so that you may define your own success. Thank you again so much for joining us this evening at the first of what is certain to be a long and successful series of invigorating discussions about entrepreneurship and the many pathways to success. Please join me now in welcoming Dan Dizio, ESU class of 1995 and CEO of Philadelphia Philly Pretzel Factory. Dan.
We're going to show you a quick video here, I think just to give you some B-roll, which just to give you some familiarity with the pretzel business. I don't know if anybody's, just by a show of hands, who's been to a Philly Pretzel Factory before? Oh, perfect. Keep me in business, that's great. So that's terrific. Well, why this is running, You know, I just want to say it is truly an honor to be here. I know people say that all the time when they give speeches and all, but for me to graduate from here and to come back, it gave me goosebumps to drive up here. I was really excited about it. You know, being here, it's been almost 20 years now. I graduated in 95, 22 years, and it just flew by, and I have so many great memories of this school. And I can tell you, if I didn't come to the East Stroudsburg University, I definitely wouldn't be where I am today. The relationships that I built, and I'll go into some of those later, were forged and made here at East Stroudsburg. In fact, while I was driving up here, I called my mom to tell her I was coming up here and, you know, to speak. And, you know, she started crying when I was on the phone with her, and she was that flattered. So if nothing else, if you get nothing out tonight from me, know that you made my mom very happy tonight, very proud. So I appreciate that. So a little bit about the story about how I got into the pretzel business. I think it should give you a little bit of a background on it. So I grew up in a town called Bensalem, right outside of Northeast Philadelphia. My next door neighbor owned a pretzel bakery. Sure enough, when I was 11 years old, I was out back kicking a ball, and my next door neighbor came over and he got stuck with 1,000 pretzels that Saturday morning. And he basically asked if I would stay on the street corner and we'd sell the pretzels and split the money. Back then, pretzels were five for a dollar, a long time ago, and sold them, brought in $200. I got 100, he got 100. And at the time, my allowance was $3 a week. So this was 9 months worth of allowance in one day. So I hit the gold rush. So I said, let's do it again. And you know, this is, I'm 46 in a couple weeks. So this is a long, 35 years ago. And so did it then. And then next thing I know, every weekend I was selling pretzels on the street corner. Then after school, I was selling pretzels on the street corner. And within a couple months, everyone in school found out that I was selling pretzels, making all this money. I used to walk around with big wads of $1 bills, so it really looked like I was even making even more money than I was. And so, sure enough, my job somehow became the organizer for this guy, Steve, who would tell me, I need 45 guys today. And this is way before cell phones, text messaging, you know. I would have to do the old-fashioned way, call 45 guys at 5:30 in the morning and say, meet us at 6:30 or 7 o'clock in the morning, and we set us up all around Philadelphia. Every corner, if anybody's down from Northeast Philadelphia, every street corner was full of them. And you know, I can't believe, in fact, I make the joke all the time. Before, when he asked me if I would sell pretzels, he said, one thing's first, I have to ask your mom if it's okay for you to sell pretzels on the street corner. And for some reason, my mom said it would be okay for me to stay on Roosevelt Boulevard, which is a 12-lane highway if anybody knows the road. I'm still always amazed by that. She hates when I tell that part of the story. She goes, leave that part out. She goes, it was a different time back then. That's her story. So I did it all through middle school, into high school. And once I went to high school, I told the president that I would not bring the story up, but I actually am going to throw it in there. So I was doing so well in the pretzel business, I stopped going to school. Not a good thing to do, but I did stop going to school. I just started selling pretzels every day, 7 days a week. I was making a lot more than I could ever dreamed I was going to make. And so until that one fateful day in May, I remember clearly, it was right after my birthday, May 7th, I got a door, ringing the doorbell, and two sheriffs were there. And they're there to arrest my mom. And my mom's in the shower. So they go upstairs, they knock on the door, and they arrest my mom in a bathrobe for me for selling pretzels on the corner. They thought my dad had died a couple years prior, and they thought my mom was forcing me to sell pretzels to feed the family. And she had no idea. I was taking report cards. She had no clue. But long story short, I got on the straight and narrow, and I did pretty good in school after that. From that point on, we got straightened out. It was an eye-opening, awakening moment for me. But again, still did it on the weekends and still did it after school. Even when I came to East Stroudsburg, I would still go home on the weekends at the first beer and go and sell pretzels. So it was sort of what I loved to do, and it was very lucrative back then. Started playing ice hockey up here, and then I stopped with the pretzels, and it's sort of where it ended. Graduated, became a stockbroker, and just was not used to sitting at a desk all day. Just was very difficult for me. So did it for about a year, and kept talking to my partner, Len, who apparently was my partner, but at the time, we were college roommates here in East Stroudsburg, and kept bringing an idea up about this pretzel thing. He didn't know anything about the pretzel business. And I had said to him, listen, this is the way it works. There's 10 pretzel bakeries in the Philadelphia area, and they all go to work at 3 or 4 in the morning. They twist pretzels, They'd bake them, and they all closed by 9 o'clock in the morning. And that was sort of the way it was in Philadelphia, and they sold them to schools, hospitals, and on vendors and street corners, and that's just the way it was. And they always closed by 9, 9:30. Why someone never changed it until we came along, I still don't know that. But they did very, very well. So I told Len about it, and Len was a golfer at the time. He loved the golf when he was up in Strasburg. So he said, I could golf. All he heard, I told him we're gonna make money, da da da. He didn't hear anything else. He heard, so I could be on the golf course by 10 o'clock every day. He said, you'll be on the golf course by 10. So he was in, didn't really know much about it. And the one tricky part, the reason there was 10 pretzel bakeries in Philadelphia was there was only 10 pretzel machines in Philadelphia. No one ever let you see these pretzel machines. They produced a rope string, and without that machine, you really couldn't get in the business. And if there was 20 pretzel machines, there would have been 20 pretzel bakeries in Philadelphia. But the guys who owned them didn't let you see them because nobody wanted to have someone make one and start being competition. These guys were a real closed group. So as a stockbroker, I had access to a phone all day. So I used to call all day and try to find a pretzel machine or someone who would make me one. And sure enough, luck would have it, after almost 11 months of doing it, I found one in Florida. A guy years ago, 25 years beforehand, had tried to open a pretzel bakery up in Florida and opened up that, didn't do well, and he put it in his garage. So sight unseen, this is before pictures and email and stuff. I'm sure email was around, but not, it was 1998. We flew to Florida with our life savings in our pockets. And we went down there and we find this machine. The guy opens his garage up in some time. Now, I'd been in the pretzel business a little bit, but at that point I knew the business a while. But Len had never even seen a pretzel machine before. And this thing, a lawnmower, was sitting on top of this machine that was made out of plywood and wires sticking out. And this was our life savings we were buying this machine with. And everything that we've ever worked for. In fact, he borrowed the money for his. I went with a different approach. I decided that maybe they don't still have them, I don't know, but I went and got credit cards and I opened up a bunch of credit cards. This isn't a well thought out business plan, by the way, so this is what not to do. So I went and got 10 credit cards opened up and I cash advanced all the credit cards for the maximum I could get. That's where I got this money. So now we're in Florida with this cash. We're about to buy this machine, and it looks, I've seen pretzel machines before, but this is the worst one I've ever seen in my life. And Lenny pulls me aside and goes, there is no way that I'm taking my life savings and putting it on that. He goes, this isn't even my money I'm using to buy this thing. So I agreed with him. I really did. I said, I just can't risk everything we have. We're 24 years old, and we're putting everything on the line for this thing in someone's garage. And Lenny said, well, can we plug it in and see if it works? Well, he's like, it's three phase, if anybody knows what that term means. And basically it means you can't plug it in someone's house anyway. So we leave. Now we flew to Florida, but we rented a U-Haul truck to come home because we thought we're coming home with a pretzel machine. Well, it turns out we don't have a pretzel machine in the back of the truck. And I drive, this is a true story, I drive about 50 yards and I stop the truck at the stop sign. And swear this is not made up at all. I sit there and I go, Len, if we go home, we're going back to what we're not happy about our life. And this is a point where we can make a decision, go this way or we can go that way. And I said, I just don't want to go that path. I want to take the chance. We had the opportunity, let's take the chance here. It was this real inspirational story, and I'm not that guy. I usually don't have that kind of quote, but I really did have this plea with him because I wanted it so bad. And I said, listen, let's go back and I think we can negotiate with the guy. And we agreed to buy this thing for $20,000. And so we go back and we start negotiating. Now we got to this guy's house at 11 o'clock in the morning. We have dinner at his house at 8 o'clock. We're negotiating at midnight, still negotiating. And finally at 1 in the morning, I think the guy just had enough. And we wore him down and we finally settled on $11,000. And we got the machine and we drove home again. That was really the beginning for us. And from that point, we were able to find a location. We were looking for what people typically do. And the reason I'm here tonight to sort of talk about the mistakes, but you know what we were gonna do? There was 10 pretzel bakeries out there and they were all in a warehouse on a back alley nobody knew from. And that's what we were gonna do. We were gonna rent the exact same thing as everybody else does just because they did it, right? And then we finally made a decision to put it on a retail street, on a street that people could come in and get these pretzels, not just one that closes up 9 in the morning. And sure enough, we found this location. The rent was even cheaper than the warehouse spot we were going to rent. And we ended up putting it in there. And the first day we opened, let me see here. By the way, this is the street corner the first day I sold pretzels, by the way. I jumped along here. So this, you can see, it is a 12-lane highway, and I stood right in this middle of this island there. And by the way, I'm surprised that somebody just didn't pick me up. I was the smallest kid in my high school. When I was in high school, I was only 4'11", 77 pounds. I was probably 60 pounds, so I can't even believe I was out there, and the wind didn't just blow, tractor trailer wind didn't just blow me over. But this is the way the store looked. This was the retail store we took. This is when we opened, May 2nd, 1998. And we opened up, we ran there and twisted pretzels at 4 in the morning like everybody else does, and we opened the doors at 6 o'clock and zero people were there. And at 7 o'clock, something interesting happened, the deli next door opened up to us. It was a real famous deli in Northeast Philadelphia. And people started getting their lunch meat, Saturday morning getting their lunch meat, and they started to trickle over. And by 9 o'clock, when I told Lenny we were going to be closed at, when he could go golfing, we had a line of 45 people in line. And the line didn't go away until 5 o'clock in the afternoon. And I told Lenny at the end of the day that he could sell his golf clubs because we were going to stay open the rest of the day. And really the moral of this story is we were just going to do what everybody else did. And just, you know, we didn't invent the pretzel. We really just invented the process, changed the process and the way we delivered it. And it was hot, fresh pretzels all day. The reason our tagline is hot out of the oven pretzels, it was a mistake. We couldn't keep up with the demand because Lenny was baking, I was twisting and working the door. And we would literally just bag the pretzels and hand them to people, and they were blazing hot. And you know what they would do? They were so hot, they would go, give me another 10, give me another 20. They would buy more. And we knew we were on to something special, that when you give somebody hot pretzels, they even buy more of them. And the original place was going to be a wholesale pretzel bakery, so we had tiered pricing. So the more you buy, the better the price you get. Our original pricing was $4 for $1, $10 for $2, $30 for $5, $50 for $7, and $100 was $13. So when people would come in just for four pretzels, then they were like, well, just give me 10. And then they were like, give me 30. Give me 50. And they would just sell themselves on why to buy more. They don't even know what the heck they're going to do with 100 pretzels, but they bought them. And they all justified. I could freeze them. I could do something. So that was sort of, we called something special. Now, the store was only pretzels and soda. That's all we sold. We didn't even have cheese. We did have mustard at the time. So this is how it looked when we were under construction. This is the original store. That's me and Len. I don't know what we were doing. We were sort of just makeshifting it. We didn't even open with a cash register. That's how unthought out the plan is. And it's crazy for me to come back here and see, you know, you guys had this, you know, incubator. And what's the term? I'm sorry. I keep using
incubator. Innovation center.
Innovation center. And it's so exciting to be able to know that these business practices, how much we could have learned and really taken advantage of. And I wish we would have done even more homework beforehand because we would have missed a lot of the mistakes that we had. In fact, when we came in here, we opened the store up, and the health department has to come out and give you an inspection. So we had 38 critical violations. And the guy said, absolutely not, you're not opening. And then he, as he's walking around, the funny part was, he came up to us and he's walking through the whole store, and he goes, one question for you, where's the bathroom? And I looked at Lang, and I go, we built a store and we forgot to put a bathroom in. It's a true story, no bathroom. There's no bathroom in the store. And I go, how did we miss a bathroom? So the guy goes, what are you gonna do for a bathroom? And I was like, there's a diner across the street, right? The Mayfair Diner's across the street. And he goes, what if they're closed? I go, they're open 24 hours a day. And he goes, absolutely not. We're not basing on another business. You gotta get a bathroom. So long story short, we ended up getting those things fixed. We don't have any health violations now, by the way, so you should feel comfortable that coming to our store. Here's Lenny serving our first week of pretzels. And the next year, so we had great success that first year. Made dream come true. In fact, let me cut back because I want to talk about Len here. So Len graduated in 1994. This was a dream for both of us, but man, it took off. And sometimes it's, the saying is, be careful what you wish for. Well, we never dreamed we would have the lines at the door. We would have them all day. And let me give you a picture of a snapshot of our lifestyle. We would start twisting pretzels at midnight. We would twist until about 4 in the morning, then we would deliver them to the airport. We were lucky enough to get the airport account, which was a big order for us every day, 7 days a week. We would then twist and bake all day long until 5 o'clock. We'd close the doors at 5. We'd drive to Sam's Club. We would load our car up with flour, and we didn't know there was places that would deliver this stuff. Again, not a well-thought-out plan. We would buy the flour, all the ingredients there. And if you ever go in Sam's Club, you know the boxes at the front of the store? We would grab all those boxes. We'd take them all. They were our packaging material. So if you ordered 50 or 100 pretzels, that was sort of what they came in early on. So we leave there, we come back, we literally sit on the floor, count up our money. We our accounts receivable was a sheet of drywall. And we would write, if somebody bought something on an account, we would write it on the wall. And if you paid us, we crisscrossed it out. And that was sort of how we started this business. Again, not a well-oiled machine here, to say the least. But you know, we had something special. People loved the product, they loved the pricing, loved everything about it. But man, it was a curse. So after we did that, so it's about 7 o'clock, we used to go home every night for 1 hour. We'd eat dinner and shower. We'd come back and we'd sleep on the flower beds from 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock every night. And the reason being is, if one of us would have went home and slept in a regular bed, we would have never made it to work. So by sleeping there, we did 7 days a week. In fact, it was so good, the business was so good, 3 months into it, we were exhausted. I used to put my car in park at red lights because I would drift into the traffic if I would fall asleep at the light. And Lenny came to me after 3 months and he said, here's the keys. I don't want it anymore. I'm not interested in it. And he said, the reason I got in this was the quality of life. And I wanted something better for my family and the quality of life. And this is no life. I haven't seen my wife. I'm trying to have a baby. I'm trying to have a family. And I'm trapped in this store all the time. And at that point, it was an eye-opening moment because I didn't have anybody else. Now, it could have been a great deal for me. I could have got the store, half the store for nothing. But I didn't have anybody else. I mean, there was no way for me to do it all by myself. So that's when we had the epiphany moment of, we got to do something different. What we're doing is we're caught in a rut, and we're just trying to do the same thing every day. And the problem is the business is getting busier every day. So we're even worse shape 3 months than we were the first day, which is hard to believe. So what we did was we called all our old college fraternity brothers. We were Phi Sigma Kappa fraternity down here on Aaron-Wilming Street. We called our buddies and we said, whatever you're making, we'll pay you more than you're making. And everybody said, okay, it'll be like a big frat house in there. We're gonna be buddies again, hanging out. Everybody agreed. I was telling this story earlier. So I called one other person. He did not agree right away. So he said, let me sleep on it and I'll get back to you. And he goes, calls me the next morning and goes, I slept on it, and he goes, I really should take it, but I really like what I'm doing. I got passionate for what I'm doing. And it was, most people probably know, it's James Franklin from Penn State head coach. He was coaching at the time, and he was struggling. It was early in his career, and it was not a well-paying job back then. And he's the one guy that turned us down. So he's not doing as well as pretzels, but I'm only kidding. It's worked out well for him. So the reason I bring this slide up is, this is our second store we ever opened up. It went out of business. We had the best success lines at the door of the first store with no shoestring budget. The whole store cost us $34,000, the first one. The second one cost us $300,000. We bought all brand new equipment. We did everything right. We had a designer design the store, architects, blueprints, the whole nine yards, and the store flopped. And the reason I bring it up to you, if there's entrepreneurs in the room, or anybody in for that matter, you're going to have struggles. And for us to have the second store closed, it was a humbling, humbling day when that store closed. And really, a scary day. In fact, Lane said to me, I'll never do another one. That's it. I'm done. I'm going back to Mayfair. That's our original store, and we're just keeping that one. And at that point, that's when I was like, I want to grow. And it was a fluke. It's just one bad store. We got to continue to go. And I went on to open up stores without Lane. So after that first one, he's a great partner, but he just didn't want to go through that failure again and thought, you know what, we had one great one and here we are with this failure, and he couldn't absorb another failure doing a third store. But I ended up doing another store, did a store in down in Center City, if anybody gets down, this is an old photo of it, but it's 16th and Sampson. This is one of our best stores in the system now, and it was our third store. In fact, our franchisee, another guy who went to East Stroudsburg, Ron Howe, graduated in 1994 as well. He owns this store and 21 other stores. So again, the partnerships, the relationships that were started here in Stroudsburg have continued to help my company and help themselves as well. So it's been great. One thing I did a little unique is, these were some stores early on that I went and did partnerships with. So what I did was, I would find, some of these guys were East Stroudsburg alumni as well, and I would put up all the money, I would train them, and we would become 50-50 partners in these stores. And I had about 10 stores doing it this way, and it was really a success. So every year you could see I was starting to open up a store every year. Until about 2005, We ended up starting franchise in 2005. We had someone come to us and want to partner up and open a franchise. And the reason you see the Monopoly board is, it was kind of a special one for me. So my first franchise was at Boardwalk and Park Place, right on the corner of Boardwalk and Park Place. I'm a huge Monopoly guy. So for me to open up the first location there, and it was a huge success and really catapulted us because they told a bunch of people how well they were doing. And sure enough, it caught on, and that's why the franchising model started really working. The next year, we started really growing and doing well. But guess what happens when you do well? People copycats, right? So remember all those guys I told you sold pretzels with me on the corners early on? Well, they saw me doing well, and they all opened up stores. And they went and did their own thing and did the stores. So these three guys were all competitors. And this is a crazy story when I tell you this. At one point, every one of us had 22 stores on the button. Everybody had 22 stores at the exact same point, which is just mind-boggling that we all get to the same point. The only difference was me and Len had decided that we made a commitment early on that original store I showed you, that me and Len would live off that store forever. That was it. Anything that this franchise thing did, we didn't know how well it would do, these multiple stores, we were going to put all that money back into the infrastructure of the company and continue to hire people, and that's what we did. We were fortunate enough that Rita's Water Ice, I'm sure everybody knows Rita's Water Ice, they are right up the street from us. They got bought out at the same time a private equity firm bought them out, and they let go a lot of employees. And fortunate enough for us, they were a regional concept that everybody said, Water Ice can't franchise that all around the country. So we were able to take a lot of those employees and hire them, and we really added to the infrastructure. And over the next couple of years, we ended up buying out Taste of Philly, the bottom one, Jim's and Pretzel Boys collectively, one has two and one has three stores left. And pretty much, they're not franchising anymore. And really, the moral to this story is that, you know, if you add to the infrastructure, you know, somebody asked me earlier if I could give any advice. And so one thing is, we were doing pretty well financially with these stores, but we didn't go and change our lifestyles for it. We added adaptive business because, frankly, you know, the business mattered more than my lifestyle. And in fact, I joke around that the store had flat screen TVs way before I had a flat screen TV in my house. And that's what a true entrepreneur does. They care more about the business than they care about their own stuff. And frankly, some people will say, well, what about, you know, I want to get into being an entrepreneur because I want to make a lot of money. And that is not the reason to be an entrepreneur. I can tell you that. There's other ways to make money. To be an entrepreneur, they go through the headaches and the ups and downs, the late nights. You have to do it because you believe and you want to build something and you enjoy it and you don't mind sacrificing Friday nights and Saturday nights with your friends to be in business. It was truly humbling those first couple of years for me and Len. We used to always get shore houses when we went to East Stroudsburg, down in the South Jersey Shore. And on Fridays, when we used to work, we'd be working Friday nights because we had so many orders for Saturday. People used to stop in and get pretzels on the road to the shore. And let me tell you, it's very difficult when you're 25 years old to stand there and twist pretzels and know you're going to do that all weekend and all night when all your friends are going to the shore and having a good time. And the only thing that gets that through those weekends is that you believe in what you're doing and you enjoy and you want to get to a certain climax and a certain spot in life. And you're willing to sacrifice those weekends to be that passionate about the business. So as the time came, we put in infrastructure. The things that changed it was for us, we really created an executive team. We hired from the Reedus, as I told you. We had to create a development department, which was great. We got the former CEO of Mako is our chief development guy now. We had support managers that visit the stores. We hired a marketing company, and then we have our own in-house marketing as well. We had research and development, had hundreds and hundreds of products in the pipeline. And people say, where are all of them? Because I know you guys have the party trays, I know you have the cheesesteak pretzels and all. The problem for us is, the one thing that we believe in this, one of our founding principles, is the simplicity of the model. People go to the pretzel store, they know what they're going to get. We don't want to become a convenience store or to compete with other businesses out in the world. Sometimes we have franchisees who want us to add more items, more sandwich pretzels, make it a pretzel deli, add this, add newspapers, chocolate milk, add all these things. And the problem for us is, you know, that's such a competitive world. In fact, when I was 14 years old, I used to ride my bike up to a bike shop. There was a McDonald's next to it. And I used to buy a cheeseburger there, 69 cents for a single cheeseburger. This is 32 years ago. I could go to that same McDonald's 32 years later, and I could buy a double cheeseburger today for 99 cents. And that shows you how competitive the food industry is. So me and Landon and our franchisees are in this world where we're just making pretzels. We do a tremendous amount. We're doing 175 million pretzels this year. But we're in this world where we don't have any direct competition. There's all competition out there. Every food is competition. And people always say Auntie Anne's. We don't look at them as competition. They're a mall-based business that isn't really what we do. Our average customer buys 35 pretzels when they come in our store. It's a lot of pretzels for people to come in. So after that, we started to hire PR firms. One of the early things we did was hire a PR firm, and man, it made a difference. It was the one best advice I gave it earlier to some young entrepreneurs is, if you don't have a big marketing budget, the best thing you can do is to do PR. Whether you do it yourself and mail things out to newspapers, articles, to news magazines, they're looking for content. But we hired a company and they did tremendous for us. I mean, the amount that it cost us is a fraction to the value we received. We could never buy the amount of advertising that we get with the PR side of it. Traditional, the pretzel is our baby. It still is and probably will be forever. I mean, the traditional pretzel is really our core products that we have, but we have added the pepperoni melt, cheesesteak pretzels. The pretzel party tray, which didn't even exist 10 years ago, is 25% of our business. We have some stores that do not sell anything in their store except for party trays on the weekends. Up in Belmore, New York, out on Long Island, New York, there's a store. He does not sell regular pretzels. He's so booked up. He's going to open another location in the next couple months. But all he can do is he has full orders for party trays. It's unbelievable how well he's doing out there. As we grow, we got some recognition and are in the top 200 for Franchise Times Magazine, which is a big deal. It really gave us some credibility out there. All these things, nothing jumped us to where we are today. It's all little incremental things that have built upon each thing. And these are some of our stores, the airports, the amusement parks that we've gotten involved in. We're all over the place. And this was in 2010, we hit our 100th store, so it was a big deal. And franchising, your 100th unit is a huge, huge deal. It really sets the tone of, it's not just a regional thing, it's not just one neighborhood likes your product. Once you hit 100 stores in franchising, it's understood that that product should work nationwide and it should continue to grow. And that's where we are now, 19 states. Hopefully in the next year or two, we'll be in all 50 states. We're really starting to grow west and doing well there. With that PR, we were fortunate enough. I was fortunate enough to be on Undercover Boss, and it was a great experience for me. People ask about a lot. The one thing that's stumped about it is it's 3 weeks of no contact with your family. I have little boys, couldn't see, talk to your boys, not even on a phone call. And it's kind of funny, when the producers came out to meet me, I bombed the interview. They did an interview, and my pronunciation's not that good. It's not because of East Stroudsburg, I think it's the Philly accent. But I really thought I bombed it, and they came back and they said, listen, we think we want you. And I said, listen, I want to be up front with you. I've watched it. Everybody's seen Undercover Boss, at least one of the shows. I said, that show, those guys cry all the time. I don't cry. It doesn't happen. I don't cry. My body's not made up for that. And sure enough, I do the episode, and since it's been on, I've been ranked the most emotional guy who's ever been on. I've cried the most of any Undercover Boss ever. So. But it was a great experience. It really was a great experience. And it really gave us a platform for people to get to know the brand outside of the Philadelphia region and really understand where we are. And the first night it had 17 million viewers. So it really opened up the door. And from that, what happens is, just like everything I said, everything's a little step here, a little step. The next day after the show aired, we got a call from Walmart. And Walmart said, we want to start to put your stores inside, your bakeries inside the Walmarts. Currently, we have 37 stores inside Walmarts, and it continues to grow for us. It looks like that's going to really expand for us over the next 12 months for us. We were in a pilot program that's continued to grow, and they're really happy with the relationship. Because if you've been to our stores, we're a value-oriented menu, and it meshes up with exactly what Walmart does, is looking for value. So, this is our airport location. We opened up in 2013. You can see, the reason I'm pointing these out is it's starting to show the migration of how the company started to, we started to hire designers and add money to the stores, the finishes. And this, somebody asked me about this earlier. So did anybody see the Tim Tebow pretzel by any chance out there? So this caught on big. We did this a couple years ago when he got picked up by the Eagles. And then it was lightning in a bottle. I think we had some 17 million likes or something, or 18 million likes in the first 24 hours. ESPN was calling, every show was calling about this. And the point of this is, you never know in marketing what's going to stick. And it's somebody made this up, stupid little thing. We sent them to, when they signed them, everybody knew he was going to get cut probably from the Eagles. We sent them down to the Eagles camp. And sure enough, next thing you know, every media outlet is calling and get an interviewer wanting to see the product or come in the bakery and see it. So really the question of where are we at now, as a company. And we're our goal, we're 200 units now. We're going to be, our goal is 500 units by 2021. So we think it's very achievable and growing rapidly, really these outer markets. We don't have any plans to be international yet. We want to stay local. Well, not local, I should say nationally company, but we're not really going international. It opens a whole Pandora's box of problems and challenges that we will get to, but the country's a big country and we feel like we have a lot of opportunity before we need to go that route. And what's exciting for us right now is we are at the point of, we just moved now, I was just telling them, this past Monday, we just moved into our corporate headquarters. This was the former Rita's Winter Ice building. So we just moved into this building, and it's been a dream come true. So it's 25,000 square feet, and we're building a frozen production facility in there right now. So we're real excited where we are as a company. I mean, it's really set us up to be, you know, I had to pinch myself when I went into work this week to see the size of the operation and the amount of people. We have about 250 employees that work for the corporate headquarters. Some of those are corporate servers that we currently own, and some are just executives that work in the corporate office. So we continue to see the excitement. Some people asked me earlier about the guy who I got in the pretzel business with and what he's up to. So he's been the guy, and the reason I tell the story is I think it's, I'm not here to be an advocate for change, but I just want to give you some inputs of things that happened in my life to set me up where I feel like I'm a success. Steve, the guy who set me up on the street corner, ended up getting a drug problem. Now, this is a guy who I look up to, who set me up on these corners. So when I was doing that well on the street corners back when I was a kid, he had 50 kids out in those corners all those years, doing tremendously well. And sure enough, he ended up getting hooked on drugs. And when a few years ago, I got a ring on my doorbell, and I thought it was my girlfriend. I thought she was locked out. She was a bartender at the time. I thought she was locked out. I was going to throw the key down to her. And I looked out, and there was snow out in the ground. And sure enough, there was a cab out there. And I looked down, and it's the guy Steve I used to sell pretzels for. He was standing there naked. He sold the clothes he was wearing for crack cocaine. And the reason I'm bringing this up is it was such a moment for me. I get goosebumps thinking about it in a negative way to watch somebody I looked up to who had everything in the world to live for. Forget the money, but he had the money. He had free time. He had flexibility, everything. And he lost it all for drugs. So hence, I've never touched a drug in my life because I got to see the real world experience of what that looks like. But man, it was an eye-opener. And I suggest to anybody who wants to be an entrepreneur understand that these are the pitfalls that come along with some of the success. I told you there was 10 pretzel bakeries in Philadelphia prior to us opening up. Well, sure enough, there used to be a thing, I started to discuss this earlier, the thing was called a pretzel curse back in the day. All those pretzel guys had nothing. Now they've made millions and millions of dollars, and not one of them has any money to this day, zero. I'm not saying 9 of them, 10 out of 10 had nothing. They lost it all, and the reason they call it the pretzel curse is these guys were so caught up in working hard, making a lot of money, but when they closed at 9 o'clock every morning, they got caught up in the lifestyle of spending this money in bad ways, whether it be casinos, racetracks, other bad places. They got hooked on different drugs and they ended up losing it all. And it's a reality of any business. Now, it's in the pretzel business, but it's something I see with a lot of young entrepreneurs or entrepreneurs that have success end up going in a route like this. And it's a sad place to be. When you see it firsthand that everybody has everything you want and you dream of and you get it and so many people piss it away. So it's unfortunate part of reality of life. So so with that, I'd like to take some questions because I think I have so many stories to tell that I want to make sure I have time to get some feedback from you guys.
All right. So.
Oh, I'm sorry. Is that the next?
Okay.
Yeah. Who has a question?
Hi.
Testing 1, 2.
Can you give your name to start, by the way?
My name is Trayvon Bradshaw, and I know one thing you talked about is how your second business had failed, and Len, he didn't want to open up any other businesses after that because of the feel of failure. So I was wondering, did you have that same feeling? And if so, how did you overcome that fear? What helped you to, like, persevere, push on?
Well, I think, and Len would be, if he was here, he would tell you the same thing. I think Len was, two things is he was married, so it was a little different. One thing I do tell people is there's such a benefit. You can start a business at 100 years old, but there's a huge benefit when you start younger because of the fact that the scary part is when you fail, if I would have failed, my mom loves me. She would take me back in, hopefully. And, she would let me live there, and I could. But when you have responsibilities to other people and kids and family, and he was in that spot, I think he was too scared to give his. It was because of the family. It's really what it comes down to. I didn't have that. Plus the passion for the business. I wanted to be successful. I would have failed 5 more stores and continued to go to the next one. I think that's what you're built with, that mindset of, you know, I'm going to continue to make it grow and work. And you know, I've been fortunate enough to be around other entrepreneurs, and they have the same mindset. They've all had that failure story. There's a ton of them. There's people in this room that have had these stories, that have seen failures, and it's those guys. And you're going to have them. There's no doubt about it. And whether it's life, it doesn't have to just be in business. It's life, and it's going to knock you down once in a while. So, okay.
Doing Undercover Boss, were you at all concerned with how media would portray your company and whether it would portray it in a positive or negative light?
Yeah, that's I'll tell you, these companies that do this, it's really scary because we were, at the time we went on the show, we were the smallest company to ever be on Undercover Boss. And I look at it and go, I wasn't worried about embarrassing myself on the show. I was really worried about the fact that we had people's life savings wrapped up in these stores. And if I did something wrong, it could damage their store. And that's really scared me. But I think about some of these other companies that had billion-dollar companies, multi-billion-dollar companies, and they could damage the brand so badly on the show. Has anybody seen the one with the episode of Hooters on there by chance? Mm-hmm. Okay. Hooters aired on Thursday night. So on Hooters, if you've seen it, it wasn't the best episode. It didn't make the CEO look that good, to say the least. Checkers, if you're familiar with Checkers was going to buy out Hooters on Monday, the next Monday. The deal, the Hooters CEO made it look so bad that they killed the deal. That's how it was that poor of a show. So I knew about that effort. I knew that it happened. So it was definitely scary. What if somebody says something inappropriate? Do I jump in? Do I not jump in? There was no doubt. There was a lot of fear. For us, the fact that we could never pay 17 million people watched the first night it aired so many times. We could never buy that kind of advertising, so we took a chance. The only thing is we were in season 3, and so the first 2 seasons aired, and they were pretty much, for the most part, they made the CEO look pretty decent, a positive light, I think most people would say. Well, I was, the first episode of season 3 was a place called Diamond Entertainment. I don't know if anybody saw that one. It was a timeshare place. Well, the guy was, to say the least, horrible. I mean, they really made him look bad. And I was like, oh my God, they're gonna turn this on me. And they made the first 2 years the CEOs look good. Now the third year is to bash the CEOs, because the scary part about this show is they tell you, they can change your voice and say whatever words you want to. So what happens is, you go into a studio after films, and you go in and say words. A, B, B, Z, and they're like, we can make it say anything you want. In fact, At the end of mine, I bought a gentleman a new car on the thing. They didn't air that part. They dubbed it in and bought him health insurance. But I had bought the guy a new car. And I was like, that's not what I said, but they completely dubbed it in, and it's amazing they could do it. So I was so, and I knew the contract was 700 pages, and it's take it or leave it. You can't really negotiate that kind of thing. So it was so scary to think, if I make this look come off bad, what it could do. And really, again, I was worried more about the franchisees being affected in a negative way, because again, it could ruin the business overnight. And people, again, put everything they have into this business. In fact, some people say me and Len were risk takers. I didn't really think we were that big risk takers, 24 years old, 25 years old, no kids, no real family at the time. We only had to support ourselves. We have franchisees that come in all the time that, you know, have got let go from corporate America after being in it for 25 years. Sad stories, and they can't find another job, and they're, you know, 52 years old, 55 years old, and they're saying, I'd rather just control my own destiny. I'll take all my money and put it in this. Well, it's a scary part because they got kids. They got kids wanting to go to college. There's a lot of responsibility, and it falls on your shoulders to hope they do a good job. And sometimes you have to turn them down, which is amazing. Like, you know, they want to sign up, and we turn them down all the time. We turn down 2 for every 3 candidates that come in because we don't think they'll be a good fit for us. But we're protecting ourselves and the brand, but we're also protecting them because we don't want them to put $300,000 into an investment and lose it all. And it potentially that really could happen. So it was truly scary.
I've seen Wawa, you know. They don't franchise.
What's that, Wawa?
Wawa. And so I'm just wondering, you know, did you ever consider not to franchise and just expand?
Yep. Well, truth be told, Wawa used to franchise. So Wawa, I grew up in Ben Salem, and Wawa still had a franchise in Ben Salem until last year. They bought the last guy out. So they used to have 34 franchises, just to give you a little enlightenment, on Wawa. And eventually they decided to go to corporate stores, so they changed their mindset and do corporate stores. And we had thought about that. Originally, some days I still think about waking up, believe me when I tell you. I had 10 stores where I did a 50-50 partnership where I owned 100% of the company, but I shared 50% of the profits. I did that up to 2005 when we started franchising. The problem for it is it really is tough to grow and continue to run that many stores and get that many good people to operate the stores. It has come up, and once in a while we go, oh my God, I wish I could do it, because it's franchising is tough in the sense that when I go into a store, they're partners with us, right? So I can't just walk around and tell them, fix the light bulb, pretzels don't look good, and point it out. I really have to explain why these things are beneficial to your business and really educate them. I can't go in as a dictator and just tell them what to do. It has to be a collaborative effort. Sometimes that's tough, to be honest with you. And sometimes I go, man, I'd rather just own all the stores. But for me, 200 stores and $300,000 a piece would be an expensive number to borrow that kind of money. And it's out there, potentially, but the run would be a nightmare. And sometimes we can't get in places like the Philadelphia Zoo. We might not be able to get in the zoo or Philadelphia Airport, for that matter. We got in the Philadelphia Airport. That was because the franchisee had a relationship within the airport. So I would have never been able to do that without franchising. Just like McDonald's. McDonald's could afford to open up a lot more McDonald's corporate stores. They do it because they need good operators to run the stores. And that's really what it is.
Thank you.
No problem.
My name's Kevin. My question is, in the beginning when you were first starting out, did any of your family or friends doubt you? And if so, how did you respond to that?
My mom did not, but I didn't borrow any money from her or anything. I didn't want to burden her with borrowing from her. Friends did. I'll tell you, friends were very negative. People couldn't believe we were going to quit our jobs. They were stable jobs. They were okay jobs. We could have an okay life. But I will tell you this. People have said this before. People are going to be negative on a business, especially one like ours that no one did it before. And there was a lot of naysayers out there. You know, when I've talked to other entrepreneurs, they've gone through it all. And the reason they say it's people want you to succeed. There is a lot of people that want you to succeed. But also sometimes your close friends don't want to see you get out of the their world. They want to be together with you. And by you having a business or going off, there was a lot of negative, and they were not positive. In fact, it wasn't supposed to be me and Len together. It was supposed to be a few other people, and they chose not to want to do it with us. And I'm sure they regret that decision now, but it was supposed to be more people. But and then even the people we approached about it, the family and friends, that we brought the idea up before we actually did. We sort of started telling people we were thinking about it before we were already doing it. We were in the midst of it all. But when we told everybody we were thinking about it, and the reason we said that was because they were so negative on it that it was, we could say, well, we're just thinking about it. It was one of those kind of things. But there was a lot of naysayers. And it's going to happen, there's no doubt, especially when you're going to sort of challenge the norm in this business. You know, if you think about, I gave you the prices. We were selling 100 pretzels for $13. Just think about what it takes, how many pretzels you need to sell to make a living out of it. You know, it seems unreasonable, and sometimes I go, who's eating all these pretzels? I mean, 175 million pretzels is a lot of pretzels every year, and it continues to grow and grow. But yeah, it's amazing.
Hey, when you were opening your own stores in the beginning, could you just talk a little bit about some of the factors that would influence your decision on where to put them, and what would you really consider were the big influencing factors as far as costs, like employees or taxes or payroll or healthcare?
Well, two things on that. One is, you know what's crazy? My biggest fear opening business up was taxes and payroll. Like, they were the scariest things. And by the way, they're the two easiest things because someone will do those, and there's so many experts out there that can give it. I should have been worried about, how am I getting customers? How am I gonna make the product? All those things, but I wasn't even thinking about that. I was only thinking about, and it scared me to death, almost scared me not to do it, the payroll and stuff. Location-wise, we learned a lot. We've closed stores. I don't want to make it seem like we have 200 stores and every one was a success. We've closed stores. In fact, one of the early stores, we ended up going to Westchester University, right off of campus Westchester, and the reason we went there was, it was a college. We were like, oh, all those students, they'll eat pretzels and all. And you know what we realized? It was one of the biggest mistakes ever. We don't do 1% of our business with Westchester University, yet it's only a few hundred yards away from the store. And you know what happened is we didn't know our own business. I told you earlier, our average person buys 35 pretzels. I went to East Stroudsburg here for all those years. Len, my best friend and roommate, he didn't buy me a slice of pizza one time. Not one time. In fact, I remember going to a pizza shop right here, and the slice was $1.10. He bought a slice already, and he had extra 10 cents, and I needed it. 10 cents, so I didn't have to bring $1. And he goes, I'm not giving you the 10 cents. College kids typically, in a way, they're selfish in the sense that not selfish in a bad way, but we have to watch every dollar that we have. We can't go in and say, let's buy beers for everybody at the bar. We can't go and say, let's buy 50 pretzels to take back to the fraternity house. We didn't have that kind of money. So Westchester's not that type of school. People would come in and buy one pretzel at a time. Thankfully, Westchester University is a county seat, so there's tons of lawyers, and a lot of the lawyers would come in and get boxes of pretzels for their whole staff and stuff like that, so it really made that store successful. But I got one story to tell you about, another story, because I have a sort of a positive and a negative on story. You saw it there, I told you I had a couple stores, one in Morristown, New Jersey. I opened up in Morristown, New Jersey. By the way, we had this huge success in Philadelphia, things were going great in Philadelphia. I said, let's go to Morristown, New Jersey, we'll start franchising. Guess what everybody said? It'll never work in New Jersey. I go, it's 15 minutes from Philadelphia. It'll never work. Just like I heard it'll never work with the original store, I heard it'll never work in New Jersey. The water's different, this or that. They don't eat them in Jersey. So I ended up doing the store myself. I had opened a store up in Morristown, New Jersey, and did really good right off the bat. In fact, I paid for the store in 4 weeks. It was my best store ever. In 4 weeks, I paid for the whole entire store. I got in very reasonable on that store. So me and my partner, and again, I have a partner there, he's an operating partner, he's 50-50 there. I said, let's go to the next town, a couple towns away. We go to Cherry Hill, New Jersey. And it's only a couple months later, we're doing this, like 2 months after we open out, 3 months. So we open up in Cherry Hill, New Jersey, and the store, what my luck again, it's another dud, right? So first one's great, a couple miles down the road, same clientele, same customers. It just doesn't work. So long story short, my partner works it out for a couple months. He's there, he's working there. And one day I go to the Mayfair store, the original store. Now the Mayfair store does tremendous amount of volume. I mean, millions of pretzels a year at that particular store. So I go there on a Saturday morning, 5 o'clock in the morning, I'm driving in, my employees don't expect me coming there, and I pull up, and guess what? They're all sitting on the curb out front. There's 11 employees sitting on the curb. And I caught me a moment, like one of those, you're supposed to be working, and our rule is you're not allowed to take breaks together, and you have to take breaks in the back of the store, you're not allowed to take them out front. So they're like, no, the power's off. And I go, what do you mean the power's off? They go, there's no power. I go, the lights are on. They go, the three-phase power. Well, three-phase makes the mixer work, and without the mixer, we can't make dough, and we can't have pretzels. So I go, oh my God. So I saw a Pico crew, electric crew down the street, and I went up to them, and I said, listen, what's going on? He said, your three-phase is out, and it's going to be out all day. And I was like, oh, it's a beautiful Saturday in June. We're going to miss the whole day. So now I had that store in Cherry Hill, New Jersey. It's a dog. It's doing horrible. So I said, you know what? I have a van, get my van, bring the flour with us, jump in his van, and we'll go over to Cherry Hill, New Jersey. And we have two vans, and we basically go in there. I don't tell them I'm coming. There's only two employees at that store, a counter person and a baker. That's all they needed, so slow. We walk in with bags of flour over our shoulders, like a military operation. 15 people are coming in. And I keep one girl back at the main store, the Mayfair store. And we're twisting away, and these two employees have never seen this many pretzels being made. And every 15 minutes, we pull a truck up, we load up between 600 and 800 pretzels. And we put it in the van, and we drive it back over to Mayfair store, because the soda in it, the cases work, everything else at Mayfair. So we sell pretzels all day long, day goes off, perfect. Perfect day in Mayfair. So at the end of the day, I go back to the Cherry Hill store, and I stop in there, just because I'm going to clean the store up. And the reason I was cleaning up is my partner at that store did not benefit from the Mayfair store because we just brought our own flour and my own crew. I didn't use anything of his. So I was going to leave him a couple extra dollars just for maybe I burned a little more gas that day. And I went to close out the register. If anybody knows what close out register, you put it on Z. And basically, you hit the thing, and it'll give you a total, and it clears the total out for it. So the next day, they start at zero. Okay, so I go to clear it out. And normally my goal, what I would have done there is I'm going to take the money, I rubber band it with a receipt, I drop it in the safe. I'm not going to count it. That's his job. We'll count all the money. So I do it. I turn the key, and I look, and the sales are 2.5 times the best day we ever had there, right? 2.5 times. We've been there 3 months. We haven't had a day even close to this. So I said, you know what happened? One of my employees came there and touched the wrong key on the register and added an extra zero a couple times and made this crazy number. So sure enough, now I got to count the money. So I count the money out, and the money's right. It's right what the register tape said. So I called Pat, the owner there, and I said, Pat, did you forget to close out the register? Did you leave the money in the register? And he goes, no. He goes, yesterday was the normal Friday. So I count the money again, make sure I didn't mess up or anything, trying to figure it out. And then it dawned on me. Basically, nothing changed that day. And this was one of those aha moments. The only thing that changed that day is we looked busy. We had 16 employees in a store that normally has two. We had boxes of pretzels walking out to the car with steam coming off of them. And that was the draw. And that's the energy. And we've all seen it, by the way. Does anybody go to Ocean City Boardwalk, down the Ocean City Macanaco's Pizza on the boardwalk, right? We all walk by 50 pizza shops. And what one do we stop at? The one that has the line, right? We're drawn to the line. And that's what we've learned early on is the energy it creates. It creates energy. People want to be around other people. And when they associate lines with freshness, it must be good. They're standing there. We all follow each other. And that's what was key. And once I learned that, so you know what I changed? In our franchise agreement, you sign a contract that you have to give away 3 free pretzels for the first week. That was our contract. We put it in there. People were like, crazy that I'm spending all this money that you're making me give the product away? Are you crazy? And we put it in there. And what we found is it's amazing how many people it brings in right from the beginning. In fact, we do it every year. National Pretzel Day is April 26th in a couple weeks. If you go to any one of our stores, pretzels are free all day. Right? Free pretzels. This is what's crazy about this. Guess what the best day of the year is, sales-wise? April 26th, National Pretzel Day is the best day of the year. We're giving away the product for free. And what we learned is, if you do it the right way, and you give someone free, if anybody's been in one of our National Pretzel Day promotions, you walk in, you go, hi, how you doing? Here's a free pretzel, anything else I can get you. And you know what? People feel almost awkward that they accepted something, and they go, because we've been trained to reciprocate, right? At least, you know, you go to, even your birthday present, someone gives you a birthday present, right? Thank you note. You feel an obligation to do something. Anybody ever get a Christmas present or a gift and they weren't expecting it, they didn't know they were that good of friends, and they get it, you feel horrible, and you go over to the top and buy them a crazy gift, right? So that's sort of the mindset we've learned early on, that you can, it's amazing what it does, free pretzels for us, and we require them to do it. In fact, we had Stuart in Baltimore, Delaware. So a girl said to me, she goes, Dan, you're going to be my coach besides, you have all these corporate people, but I want you to be my coach. And tell me every week where I should go. I said, you should give away three free, she bought the store, it was already open. She bought it, but she goes, I want to take it to the next level. So I said, give three free pretzels away for a week. Anybody walks in. She goes, no problem. So she's done unbelievable. She does great. Well, guess what? I have to call her 6 months later. She's still giving away three free pretzels to every customer that walked in 6 months later. And she's doing tremendously well. Because people, again, came in for three free pretzels. And they're like, give me a cheesesteak pretzel, give me a soda, give me a party tray. And it only costs 7 cents to make a pretzel. So there's no better advertising. If anybody knows anything about making impressions and advertising, there's no way we're going to do ads for 7 cents for an ad. And we can give away free pretzels all day long. So for us, it's overwhelming. How successful that promotion's been over the years and continues to be. Any more questions? Good.
So I was curious. My name is Stacy. I was curious how many pretzels you think you eat in a year?
I eat one pretzel every day. I like the end pretzels, the real dark end pretzels, burnt, not a lot of salt. I dip them in cream cheese. I always get the cream cheese and scoop it in there. That's my favorite. And it is amazing though, how many people have the, I like the middle pretzel, I don't like those, I like, so when people come in, they'll say, oh, give me those ones on the bottom, I like them real dark, I like the burnt ones, I don't like, everybody's got a one particular pretzel they like. And what's interesting is, all our pretzels are hand twisted. If you've been in the stores, they're hand twisted each day. And every single pretzel, not one of them looks the same, it's like a snowflake. So everybody, in my store, we have 50 employees at that Mayfair store, and I can tell the 50, different twists, who's twisted which ones. You can see the way they spread out. They all might look the same to you, but to me, they all look dramatically different, each one. So when you really look at the pretzels, how to twist them.
Hi, my name is Tanya. I'm a small business owner, and we are just in the very beginning stages of franchising. What would you say was your biggest hurdle when you first started franchising?
Biggest hurdle. One thing is the legal part of franchising. So let me explain. I don't know if everybody understands really what a franchise is. They did a survey recently, and they asked people what a franchise was and a chain. And I don't think people think they're the same thing. They're really not. So Starbucks is a chain, and Wawa is a chain, where they're owned by one person. A franchise is somebody who creates the model, and then they sell that model. They let people use the name, the recipes, and all the things that go into the franchise model, and they pass a royalty. So my royalty is 6% of their sales. So for every $100 they do, I get $6. And then I also get $2 that goes into a marketing fund that we use for marketing all the stores. So that's sort of the model of franchising. But one of the big hurdles is the legal part of it. Really trying to, the contract has got to be so well thought out. If you don't mind, can I ask you what your business is?
Popcorn Buddha.
Okay, Popcorn Buddha. So you wouldn't believe, yes. You wouldn't believe the pitfalls that potentially are out there. I mean, what is the, where you get the popcorn from? Do you have a backup popcorn? You know, where the kernels from? Those are all the things that we sort of work at. And it took us about a year and a half to get the real document precise. And it's a live document. We're always changing the document every year. We have to add things because things come up that you go, that'll never, I remember sitting with a lawyer going, that'll never happen. And sure enough, it has happened over and over again. So it's one of those things, but I think the contract was the big one. The one other part is really when you're small, the franchise thing is, there's a level of, you want the relationship with the franchisee, but ultimately what ends up happening is you have a lot of friends and family get into the business, right? So my first 15 franchises, 10 of them were East Stroudsburg University alumni, friends of mine. And the problem is, when you have friends in the business, it really creates some strength. strike. But by the way, every franchise company that you talk to, the first 10 or 15 stores are always friends and family. It's just the way it is. It always starts that way. So it's always a challenge.
Any other questions?
Actually, I have a question. What caused your second store to fail?
You know, it's funny, we really don't know. I'll tell you, the problem, we did everything right. We thought we did everything right. And we still challenge and question all day. And we've seen stores that just don't do well for some reason. It's just not always a guarantee. And it was really a tough one for me to decide to close it. But sometimes taking a step back is a good step forward. Some people just keep pouring money into a bad business. And we finally made a commitment to, you know, pull the plug on that. So, but I just want to say I really appreciate you guys having me up here. It's been awesome to come back and see the campus. It's a true honor for me to be up here and experience East Stroudsburg again, see the growth that it's happened. It's I'm very proud alumni. I let everybody know you've seen me. I've been on different shows and always say this this school East Stroudsburg, and some people always mispronounce the name, and I say how proud I am and how wonderful of a school and the relationships and the staff and the professors were unbelievable to me. So I really appreciate it. Thank you very, very much.